So now that we have this lifetime code, we should be able to run and see that the particle gets removed. But once we start looking at this, we're opening up a whole can of worms there, because if we no longer have any particles, what's going to be in our streams when we render? And the answer is garbage. Things we don't want to render. Of course, the fix for this is very, very simple. We just don't render anything if we don't have any particles. So only if we have more than one particle, or at least one particle, do we render anything. That's very, very straightforward and easy to understand. But we could actually refine this test a little bit further. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to copy this, and I'm going to make a function which we can use later on to detect if we have any particles left, or if all particles have ended their lifetimes. One thing we need to bear in mind here is that we might be creating a particle system where it is possible for there to be no particles, but that not all particles, that the whole particle system isn't dead or hasn't finished its run. For instance, if we create particles that randomly spawn in every 5 seconds, and we run, and they only live for 1 second, and we run it for 10 seconds, it's quite likely that there will be a long period of time where there won't be any particles, but that doesn't necessarily mean the particle system is dead or needs to be garbage collected or whatever. It's sort of a pretty vague thing. So for now, what I'm going to focus on is just having this numParticles test, and we can clean up things from outside. So we will give the user a way to see if this is happening. So see if all the particles have reached the end of their lifetimes. Bool has finished. We can call it just to start with. So that's a good start. A good start for this method. It doesn't cover a million different eventualities, but we can use that in a more interesting semantic way to say if we haven't finished, render some stuff. And then later on, we can actually use that to collect the particle system outside this piece of code. So let's try that out. Now what we should see is our particles stay up there for about 5 seconds, and then it'll vanish, because it will actually be collected, and its slot will be freed up. Okay, so now what we're seeing is that it's not there at all, and we need to investigate why that's happening. So we'll just come into the update, which is where I think the problem is happening. Okay. So how many particles do we have right now? We have one particle. Our delta time is zero. Lifetime is that. Okay, so it's not being collected. That all looks okay. And let's go and look at what happens when it renders. If we haven't finished, okay, has finished, has returned the wrong value, which is interesting because we have one particle. Let's have a closer look at has finished. So has finished returns true if the number of particles is greater than zero. Of course, we got that test wrong. It should have been equals zero. So that's why we're not seeing our particle. It should work this time. And it's there, and it disappeared. Okay, so I'm just going to redo that because I didn't unpause it quickly enough. So you see it's on our character, he's flying around, we're gone any second now, there it goes. So its lifetime's expired, it's been collected, that's working great. If we apply that effect to 1,000 particles, we'll have some pretty interesting effects happening. So the next thing to do is to think about how we're going to spawn new particles. So we've got the mechanism working where we can remove dead particles that have reached the end of their lifetime. But our add particle function is pretty anemic. It's just adding a particle to the end of the list. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to make this lifetime much smaller. I'm going to make it about half a second. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to start thinking about how to add particles at a specific rate. So we can very simply specify this just by using a rate variable. So we're going to use an finally fixed for this one. Called spawn rate. So the number of particles to spawn per second. So that's pretty easy to understand. We need to initialize it. Actually, we use floats for everything else, so we might as well use a float here too. And it will need to go into the constructor, which is starting to get quite unwieldy. And I've noticed that I've actually misnamed some of these variables here too. So I'll just fix that. So the spawn rate comes just after the radius. And if we look down here, it comes just before the texture. Okay, so now we have a spawn rate. So the way this works is we're actually going to remove this add particle. We know it works now, so we don't need to have that there anymore. We're removing the training wheels. And in updates, what we're actually going to do is first go through things. But another thing we want to do is actually spawn new particles after all of this stuff has happened. Actually, we need to do it before. So let's have a quick look at this. What we need to do is actually go look at our rate. And if you look at the documentation, it's the number of particles to spawn per second. So what we need to do is have actually a second variable, a dynamic variable, so spawn time elapse. So this is the amount of time until our next particle spawns. So it's sort of like a little countdown timer, and we're going to set that to 0 in our constructor. See, it comes after the number of particles. Okay, so our spawn time elapsed. We remove the time delta. And if the spawn time elapsed is smaller than or equal to 0, then this is when we spawn new particles. So now we call add particle. That's it. That's all we have to do. It's not going to look very impressive though, because the particles are just going to sort of flash in the same place. So what I would like to do is implement a very simple particle animation. And the way I'm going to do this is quite simple. I'm actually going to update the particle positions. So after we check if a particle is dead, we're going to add a new little piece of code. And this is just a testing of our animation. So we're actually going to take the current particle and we're actually going to move it. So we're going to move that particle and we're going to make it fall downwards. And that's a fixed position, so we want it fixed. We're just going to make it move down quite slowly. Okay. Yeah, that make it 0.05. Alright, so that will move it across the screen at a fairly good rate. But I've noticed a problem here. We have this particle reference, which is initialized up here. But once we do this particle swap thing, that particle reference, really, it's no longer valid. So what we need to think about is, okay, due to this lifetime swapping, is that going to even work? So once the particle has been swapped, we've actually invalidated our iteration across the list now that I revisit this code, and that's going to cause bugs. So what we need to do is actually move this iterator and move it backwards one step. And once we've done that, we actually need to reinitialize this pointer, so this reference. So we can't have this be a reference anymore, sadly. We're going to turn it into a pointer. Okay. Dereference it. Okay. Particles now equal to particles. Okay, there we go. address of. Okay, so let's review this. So we start out with the particle, which is at index I, whatever index that is. If its lifetime expires, we swap it with the one at the end of the list, as long as we have more than one particle. We decrement I. Actually, we shouldn't need to decrement I. No, that's incorrect. What we should do is go back to the top of the loop once that happens. Yeah, what we should do here is we should put in a continue. So we decrement I, continue goes up here, and it increments it. So we end up back at the same index, which is now a particle that was shifted in there from the end of the list. So we potentially, it could be dead too. So that will work fine. Okay, so this code will be fine as long as we don't actually start doing the lifetime check. So we can actually keep that reference as it is there. That will work very well. Okay, and then we can increment the position. So let's try that out. And we've got the spawn rate going on here. One other thing we need to do is set the spawn time elapsed once we add a new particle to be the spawn rate. Let's try that. So that every time the spawn time elapsed hits zero, it makes a new particle. It then sets the spawn time elapsed back to the spawn rate. So it's sort of like a heartbeat. We've got an error here. We can't convert parameter 5 from a string to a float. Now that's interesting. Of course, when we create the particle container, we didn't specify all the arguments. So the one we want is spawn radius and then spawn rate. And we're going to make it spawn one every half a second. Oh, let's make it spawn heaps of them every 0.25 seconds. So you're going to spawn twice as fast as they live. And I think we're going to see some interesting results here because eventually we're going to run out of space. So we're going to have to cater for that case too, where there's a very high spawn rate but a limited amount of space. And now, whoa, that's pretty cool. If you look at the player, it's kind of hard to see him but you can see he's got particles shooting out of him, moving down really, really, really fast. And I'm pretty impressed with that. It's actually quite a nice effect, and it's amazing just how much motion that's actually adding to our player character. If you look at him, it already begins to look like there's a rocket flying out of the bottom of him, or like a spotlight or something. So that's really cool. So I'm really happy that there is still some more work to do. So in the following tutorials, we'll implement a couple more things. But that's very much closer to what I wanted to do. So thanks for watching.